This is my message to you. What is my message to you today from Uncle Lee? Message today is something extremely simple. Something we've been talking about all of last year in pre-calculus. Talked about a lot this year. Vertical asymptotes and horizontal asymptotes. We're going to talk about the formal definition of these creatures. Last year, we talked about them very informally. The reason being is, in pre-calculus, you don't have this thing called a limit. We do now. We did talk about it at the end of pre-calculus, but we do have this limit now. Most of the definitions we talk about in calculus are based in this limit, concept of the limit. And here is the definition for the vertical asymptote. If the limit is x goes to some arbitrary x value, f of x, limit as x goes to a of f of x, if that limit goes to infinity, or if the limit as x goes to a of x goes to negative infinity, that by definition, then we say that x equals a is a vertical asymptote. And we're going to have a really nice example. Hey, we've been doing that. All we're doing now is this is the reason why we can call something a vertical asymptote. Horizontal asymptotes. We talked about these last year, informally, and behavior. What happens to the function when you put in Krabillion? What happens to the function as you put in negative Krabillion? If that function approaches some real number, then that's a horizontal asymptote. Formally, if the limit as x goes to positive or negative infinity of f of x, if it goes to L, L must be a real number. Then the line y equals L is a horizontal asymptote. And let's look at this. Forgot a P in there, and that's okay. But now look at this definition. As x goes to a of f of x, if that goes to infinity, we have a vertical asymptote. If x goes to a, as x goes to a, if f goes to infinity, we have a vertical asymptote. If x goes to infinity, f goes to a real number, then we have a horizontal asymptote. Two very simple definitions that we need to start verbalizing in our explanations and justifications. Let's go to the very first example. In the very first example, the first time we talked about these creatures last year was in the study of rational functions. So let's go back to a very simple rational function and analyze this rational function. And then within this rational function, I've created it in such a way that we will have a vertical asymptote and a horizontal asymptote. We, in fact, have two vertical asymptotes. But here's my function. I have it in factor form, so it's easy to analyze. Sometimes you have to factor the rational function so that we can analyze it. And then I have the same function multiplied out, where the top and bottom is multiplied out. Rational function, top and bottom are polynomials. The domain, easy enough. The domain, all reals, such that x cannot equal negative 1 or cannot equal 2. That's where the bottom is 0. That's the domain. The x-intercepts. X-intercepts happen of a rational function when that rational function is equal to 0. When the function is equal to 0, when it zeroes out. Well, that happens on a fraction when the top is 0 and the bottom is not. And then if you notice at negative 2, the top is 0, the bottom is not. At 3, the top is 0, the bottom is not. That's where these are the x-intercepts. Negative 2, 0, 3, 0. The y-intercepts are super easy. You just put 0 in for x. Put 0 in for x and then you multiply it out for them. 0, 0, 0, 0, negative 12, or negative 2 is 6, so that's the y-intercept. And now we noticed here, at these values here, and this is the next step, and this was the next step in analyzing our function in pre-calculus.
If you notice for these two values not in the domain, negative 1 and 2, that's where the bottom is 0, the top is not 0 there. The top is not 0 there, the bottom is. So what we have learned is if you have an x value where the top is 0 and the top is not 0 and the bottom is, the function explodes. We have explosions at x equals 2 and x equals negative 1. And we learned at the end of that discussion that we call those explosions vertical asymptotes. So we have for this particular function a vertical asymptote at x equals 2 and x equals negative 1. And we're going to now look at y from the definition of vertical asymptotes, the formal definition. The informal, well, the vertical asymptotes because the function explodes up, explodes down at these values right here, at those vertical lines. So let's analyze this function if we will. If we can't. So we've got a negative 2, 0, and a 3, 0. You can put these on the board so I don't lose track of them. 0, 6. X equals negative 1. X equals 2. And let's look at the start beginning. Let's begin to look at the graph. Okay? So hey, here's my yellow line, vertical asymptote right there. Right there at 2. I have vertical asymptote at negative 1. I have a y-intercept at 6. I have my only x-intercepts, negative 2, 0, 1, 2, and 3, 0. And since the multiplicity of these zeros, one each, we know that it's not going to bounce at those points, those x-intercepts. That's something else that we brought in here from our pre-calculus. This was a squared here, it would be bouncing off of this negative 2, but it's not. So we have multiplicity of 1 on both of these zeros here. So it's going to cross through the x, it has to pass through the x-axis at those points. So now let's just start graphing, and we can see immediately then it can't cross the x-axis anywhere else. And I can actually sketch the graph of this function in between negative 1 and 2 because it has to go through that point and it can't cross the vertical asymptote. So as I'm coming here, it's got to explode. It must explode up. In like manner, it has to explode up here too. It cannot explode down because these are the only two x-intercepts. So I have explosion up. So right there, that's going to lead me right into that formal definition of vertical asymptote. So the only thing I need to investigate over here is what's happening over here. Is the graph looking like this? Or is the graph looking like this? Same over here. Is the graph doing this? Or is the graph doing this? Well, we need to investigate what's going on over here. I think I'm doing that with the next slide. How do we investigate what happens over here beyond negative 2 or beyond negative 3? Because that's my x-intercept, negative 3. So let's look at f of 4. And decide if f of 4 is positive or negative. Very easy. So I'm going to put 4 into the factor form. All I really know, I could evaluate f of 4 exactly, but I don't need to. I just want to know if it's positive or negative. Because I want to know if my graph goes this way or if my graph goes this way, because the graph has to cross through that x-intercept because of the multiplicity of 1. Well, let's put 4 in. This is 2. 4 plus 2 is positive. 4 minus 3 is positive. So on the top of this right here, I have a 2, and then a times a positive, and times a positive. If I put 4 in there, 4 minus 2 is positive, and 4 plus 1 is positive. So I have 2 times positive, divided by positive times positive, and all of those positives, that makes this creature right here positive. So f of 4 is positive. So all I know is it's somewhere up in here. And so my graph is going to look like this. And therefore, it's going to shoot down. Over here is going to be positive. And we're going to see what happens over here in a moment. In like manner, let's look at, since this is my x-intercept negative 2 here, let's look what happens at negative 3. If is it positive or negative? I want to know if the graph goes like this or if the graph goes like this. Well, let's put negative 3 into that factor form over there. Okay, I have 2. Negative 3 plus 2 is going to be negative. Let me see if I can't get out of the darn way here. I'll put negative 3 in. 2 is always positive. Negative 3 plus 2 is negative. Negative 3 minus 3 is negative. Negative 3 minus 2 is negative. Negative 3 plus 1 is negative. So now I know that f of negative 3 is negative times negative is positive. Negative times negative is positive. Positive divided by positive is positive. So this f of negative 3 is positive also. So it's up here like this. Crosses through multiplicity 1. So what has to happen? It has to explode down. And I'm going to investigate this in a moment. But now look at these vertical asymptotes there at negative 1 and at 2. What's happening? What's happening? What is the limit as x approaches negative 1 from the left of f of x? What's happening? If I'm approaching negative 1 from the left. The graph is going down. The graph is going to negative infinity. Nice. What happens? If I get this up just a little bit. Whoa, that baby jumped up there. Sorry. Well, what happens now? The limit as x approaches negative 1 from the right of f of x. Where's that rascal going? If I'm approaching negative 1 from the right, the graph is also shooting up. Positive, negative. Those two things right there, those two limits together. As x approaches negative 1 from the left, goes to negative infinity. As x approaches negative 1 from the right, goes to positive infinity. That tells me, by definition, that x equals negative 1 is a vertical asymptote. In like manner, I can look at the behavior of the function as x approaches 2 from the left. From the left, it's going to positive infinity. As x approaches 2 from the right, it's going to negative infinity. That's why x equals 2 is a vertical asymptote. So when you are going to say, hey, it has a vertical asymptote, now we can no longer say top not 0, bottom 0. We can no longer say explosion. We have to say the limit. Do this in another color. The limit as x approach 2 from the left of f of x goes to positive infinity. And the limit as x approach 2 from the right of f of x goes to negative infinity. And this is the reason. These two statements say that, hey, x equals 2 is a vertical asymptote. This is the formal justification now for a vertical asymptote. All right, so now let's look at what happens. Now we need to know what's going on over here. Is it shooting up that way? Is it shooting up that way? We know it can't come back down across the x-axis because it only has two x-intercepts. Excuse me. In like manner here, we know it's not going to come back down, but it might go woo, woo. So let's investigate that. And what are we going to do? We're going to look at the Kerbillion method. We're going to say, hey, what's going to happen way over here? We're going to use the Kerbillion method here, and we're going to see where the function goes as I evaluate it at the largest known real number man, the largest real number known to man, which is Kerbillion. And so we're going to look at f of Kerbillion. And we're going to see where that function goes. In like manner, we're going to look over here at f of negative Kerbillion and see where it goes. And I think I did that on the last slide. I did. Okay, so the nicest way to do that is to use the multiplied out form of the function, which is this right here. And so now, if I'm going to put a really big number into this, and this is hard, I will tell you, this is hard for some people to see, for others, maybe not. But if I put a really big number into this function, I mean the biggest number known to mankind, Kerbillion, And I square a quadrillion, the largest known real number squared is a larger even number. And it is. Keep getting bigger. But think about that. That thing squared is massive. So much so that the rest of this, negative 2 times that, is insignificant. Negative 12, insignificant. I've got 2 times really big squared. All that's going to be is 2 times really big squared. The rest of this, insignificant. Forget about it. You don't need it. As I'm going to F of quadrillion, putting quadrillion into that, and I have to use quadrillion because you can't put infinity. F of infinity makes no sense. But F of a really big number does. You can do it. You can evaluate a function at a big number. So, and what's going to be the bottom at quadrillion? Well, it's going to be quadrillion squared. And you take a really big number, imagine that, like a quadrillion, and square it, and then subtract from a quadrillion. That's insignificant. All that is insignificant. So all I really have left is 2 quadrillion squared divided by quadrillion squared. And what do you know about a real number squared divided by a real number squared? It's 1. And 2 times 1 is 2. So that's where that function's going. So that's where that function going. And look at this. And here's my formal way that I can say, hey, what happens? What is F of quadrillion? How can I say that mathematically where the mathematicians don't get mad at me? This is how I say that. The limit as x goes to infinity of f of x, that goes to 2. Easily seen with the graphing calculator, but easily thought about also. So, the limit as x goes to infinity of f of x is 2. What does that tell us? By definition. That tells us by definition that this rascal right here is a horizontal asymptote. Y equals 2, it's a real number, is a horizontal asymptote. In like manner, look at this rascal over here. Same thing going on. Same thing. If I put negative quadrillion in, well, negative quadrillion squared is quadrillion squared. Again, the rest of this is insignificant. I put negative quadrillion in the bottom. Negative quadrillion squared, again, is quadrillion squared. The rest is insignificant. And so now I have 2 times a real number squared divided by that same real number squared. This guy here is 1. 2 times 1 is 2. So I can see that, again, this tells me what happens. How can I say that formally so that the mathematicians don't get mad at me for saying quadrillion? You can't use quadrillion for the largest real number. Kind of want to. It's nice to think about. The reason why I do is because I can evaluate the function at a really big number. And so now I have this. The limit as x goes to negative infinity, make the mathematicians happy, of f of x is equal to 2. What's that tell me? This is the definition of a horizontal asymptote. And you can have a horizontal asymptote going to 2 this way and 2 that way. You can have it going to 2 that way and negative 2 this way. You just have to be careful. This particular guy has a horizontal asymptote, but 2 going both ways. And I've talked about the vertical asymptote. I think I've just... So this is my definition of the horizontal asymptote. And if I look at that graph, and this is what's happening with that graph. The green line is the horizontal asymptote. A graph can cross a horizontal asymptote. You can't come up and down. You can't come up and down. You got a minimum exploding at the vertical asymptote. You've got the horizontal asymptote. And the other thing that we're going to use calculus for, we could actually find the derivative of this rational function and what the derivative is going to tell us. Well, somewhere in here, the derivative is going to be 0 by Fermat's theorem because there's a minimum. So the derivative has to be 0 somewhere in there. We can find that by finding the derivative of this. And we can also show that, hey, the derivative from negative infinity to negative 1 is going to be negative because the function is decreasing. And the derivative from negative 1 to this minimum is going to be negative because the function is decreasing. And here, the derivative from wherever this min is, it might be on the y-axis, who knows? But we'll find that with calculus on another day. But we know somewhere in here the derivative is going to be positive because the function is increasing. In like manner, the derivative is going to be positive from negative, from 2 on also, because the function is increasing.
And we've looked at those increasing, decreasing tests. Second derivative tells us concave. Second derivative positive, concave up. Second derivative negative here, concave down. And negative here, concave down. So a lot going on with the rational function. Really nice use. A rational function, you can find horizontal, verticals, increasing, decreasing. So today's discussion was just about vertical asymptotes, formal definition, and horizontal asymptotes, formal definition. And don't worry.